setting number 3, it begins on page 184. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgive the iniquity of my sins.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please take in hand the worship insert sheet from your bulletin. There you will find the introit for the 6th Sunday of Easter. Let us read responsibly the women taking the opening line and the men responding with the indented lines.
Come and hear all you hear,
and I will tell you what he has done for my soul.
Shout for joy to God, all the earth.
Sing the glory of his name. Give to him the glorious grace.
Bless our God, O peoples.
Let the sound of his praise be heard.
Who has kept our soul among the living,
and has not let our people slip.
Blessed be God.
Because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me.
We say together, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Come and hear all you hear from God.
And I will tell what he has done for my soul.
and by your merciful guiding, accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Scripture reading for the sixth Sunday of Easter, also known as Rogate Sunday, comes from Acts chapter 10, beginning with verse 34. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us, who have been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And then they asked him to remain for some days. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please turn over to the front side of your worship insert sheet toward the bottom. We will speak responsively the gradual. Christ is risen from the dead.
God the Father is crowned him with glory.
He has given him dominion over the works of his hands.
He has put all things under his feet.
The epistle lesson is from 1 John chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood. And these three agree. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise in honor of our Lord for the reading of the Holy Passage. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends, if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, so that you will love one another. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Congregation, may be seated for the sermon.
Thank you.
James, chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. This is our text. Dear friends in Christ Jesus, sometimes in prayer we ask for things that are not good for us, but we don't realize it at the time. I've told this story before in Bible class, but when I was a young boy growing up in Garden City, a western suburb of Detroit, my friends and I loved to play war. We would choose our sides, we would fashion weapons for ourselves, everything from sticks that we pretended were rifles to those among us who could afford cap guns. And we would play for hours, shooting each other supposedly, but mostly just arguing, "I got you, no you didn't." Well, one night back then, I was watching television and the show Combat came on, which was, of course, a favorite of my friends and mine. That night I saw for the first time something that struck me with awe and wonderment, a submachine gun. No single shots, a volley of shots. And so that night, as I, good little Lutheran boy that I was, knelt by my bedside to say my bedtime prayers, I asked God to please, please, please give me a submachine gun. Now God, in his infinite wisdom, said no to little David Sherry's earnest request, probably because if he had granted it, I would have wiped out half of my neighborhood. And I chuckle about it now, looking back, but I also wonder how often we, even as adults, ask for things that are similarly dangerous for us on a whole different level. A new job that would relocate us to a new community and thus pull us away from church. A new relationship that in the end will not work out. Sometimes that right, something that seems so right at the time right now, so good and so hopeful, but which our Father knows is not right in the end for us. So sometimes God says no. Unfortunately, some people have failed to trust God and instead feel like God doesn't listen. He doesn't answer prayer. And so they stop praying. For this and other reasons, prayer largely remains an untapped resource in the lives of many people. What good does it do to trust that God answers prayer if we never pray? Or if we pray only vague wishes, not really expecting God to respond? Or if we pray for God to show us his plan and then frustrate that plan by failing to read his word or put our faith into action. So this morning, on Rogate Sunday, the day we traditionally dedicate the seed and soil for another year, let us look at the topic of prayer. And let us learn how better to make use of this privilege that God has graciously given to us. There is power in prayer, power for everyday lives. Just as our Lord once said, "Ask, and it will be given to you." Now, it is sad that more Christians do not make use of the power of prayer. What has happened to the practice of daily prayer? Why don't more people take the time to talk with God? If I had to list the three major reasons why people do not pray, the first would be this: they do not see the need. It's like the pastor who is visiting in little Johnny's house. After discussing spiritual matters with the parents, the pastor turned to Johnny and asked, "And do you say your prayers every day?" "Yes, sir." "Before and after meals?" "Yes, sir." "And when you go to bed at night?"
Yes, sir. And do you ask the Lord to bless you in your schoolwork? Johnny paused for a moment at that one and then replied, Oh, no, sir. You see, I get straight A's. Somehow, it didn't seem important to little Johnny that he pray the Lord's blessings upon his studies. I mean, after all, how much better could he do than get a perfect report card? And we may smile for a moment, but having smiled, let us take a serious look at ourselves. How often have we forgotten to pray just because we were given straight A's? When things are going wrong, when difficulties loom large on every side, when problems seem unsolvable, then prayer seems natural and needed. But when life becomes for us a succession of beautiful mornings, when it seems that everything is going our way, when good fortune smiles on us in every turn, then prayer somehow seems a bit unnecessary. And yet prayer is never unnecessary, even when we're giving straight A's. For who is it that is giving us those A's, if not the God from whom all blessings flow? Remember, prayer is not merely a matter of asking. It is also a matter of thanking and praising, of communing and confessing. Who could ever run out of things for which to thank and praise the Lord? Or who could ever run out of things about which to speak to God? The Bible says, pray without ceasing. That means that the line of communication between us and our Heavenly Father should always be open, not just when we want or need something. But besides not seeing the need, there is another reason people do not pray more. And that is the attitude that prayer does not do much good. For example, in our text, James writes that if you lack some spiritual blessing, just ask God. That sounds easy enough. And after all, as James writes, God gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him who asks. But then James makes an important stipulation. You must pray believing. It's like the time in the old Peanuts comic strip where Charlie Brown is talking to himself and Lucy overhears. He's trying to decide what to do. He says, I know I should talk to that little red-haired girl, but if I do, something bad is bound to happen. So I guess I shouldn't talk to her. But if I don't, I will always wonder what, you know, she might have said. But if I do, what if she says something bad? Or what if she says nothing at all? So I had better not. But then again, at this point, Lucy breaks in. Good grief, Charlie Brown. You are so wishy-washy. You are the only person I know who can have a debate with himself and still lose. Wishy-washy described Charlie Brown very well. He was so full of doubts and anxieties that he went back and forth on issues without ever making up his mind. James had another way to describe this type of attitude. He writes, he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. There is tremendous power in prayer that is firmly rooted in faith. The trouble is that too often people pray without any real faith in God's ability to answer their prayers. They need to remember just how powerful and yet how generous God really is. The theme for this message comes from that part of Christ's Sermon on the Mount where he assures, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Notice the certainty of our Lord's words. He doesn't say, ask and it may be given to you. Seek and there's a chance you'll find. Knock and who knows, the door just might be opened to you. No, Christ assures that these spiritual blessings will be bestowed, no doubt about it. And this points us to one of the foremost things for which we should continually be praying, a greater faith in God's promises. The triune God, who created us, provides for us, redeemed us, and sanctifies us, has also promised to hear and answer our prayers if we will but put our trust in Him. It is through God's word that faith is created in our hearts. And it is through that same word that faith is strengthened. As we expose ourselves more and more to that word through regular worship and Bible study and devotions, we are blessed with an ever stronger faith which adds power to our prayer life. As Christ lives more and more within us, we find the power and strength to pray believing. So, lack of faith is another reason why people often do not pray. There's one final reason why people often neglect to pray. And that is because we don't follow through on the prayers that we make. It's kind of like the story of another schoolboy, 10-year-old Robert, who had not studied as he should have for his geography test. As a result, he did a lot more guessing on the test than he should have. All evening, he thought about that text and some of the answers he had given, and he was deeply troubled. What if he got too many of his answers wrong and flunked the test? That night, after he said his prayers, he suddenly blurted out the nervous petition, "And please, God, make Washington the capital of Vermont." Now, you and I may not be as naive as little Robert, but hasn't some of our praying been like his? How often have we neglected to do something we should, and then have come to God in prayer, asking Him to accomplish what we fail to do, as if by the waving of some magic wand we could be absolved from what was clearly our responsibility? How often have we deliberately done those things we know we shouldn't and have then come running to our Heavenly Father asking Him to make right out of our wrong? Or in the analogy of little Robert, how often have we in our negligence or folly said that Washington was the capital of Vermont and then, at least in effect, pleaded with our Father in Heaven to make it so? By the way, Montpelier is the capital of Vermont. It is true, our gracious God in heaven has promised to forgive us our sins for Jesus' sake. Yes, all of our sins. But that doesn't mean that He has absolved us from doing right now what is clearly our duty. The privilege of prayer is neither a license to laziness nor an invitation to inactivity. The praying Christian must still do his homework. Martin Luther once said that we are to pray as if everything depended on God, and then work as if everything depended on us. Prayer and work are not opposites. They're supposed to go hand in hand. And for this to happen, it is again going to call for a greater reliance on God and His Word. God wants to answer our prayers, every single one of them, but He often chooses to answer them through us. God gives us the strength. He gives us the ability. He even gives us the desire to accomplish the petitions of our own prayers. And when we sit idly back, we not only sabotage God's attempts to answer our prayers, we also short-circuit our petitions to Him. So, dear friends, as we celebrate once again this year, committing our seed and our soil to the Lord for another successful growing season, we pray, let us make use of the power of prayer that God has given us. Take everything to our Lord in prayer, the things we need to receive, as well as thanks and praise for what we have already received. Pray in faith, believing that the Lord, who has kept His word to save, will also keep His word in both hearing and answering our prayers. And then let us add our own work to our prayers, realizing truly that everything depends on God, but working as if everything did depend on us. In that way, the power and practice of prayer will be greatly blessed among us. And we can, with heartfelt trust in those words, declare, ask, and it will indeed be given to you. Amen. We rise. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all of our understanding, may it keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
For all that sustains, nourishes, and satisfies,
divine providence and protection we need for life.
Now give us the grace
to use our gifts of seed and soil, sun and rain wisely, to use new knowledge effectively, to share your blessings generously.
Preserve us, Lord,
from drought and flood, storm and light, fire and pestilence, from accident and illness, from corruption and mismanagement, from squander and waste, greed and selfishness, from all that destroys and diminishes your blessings to us.
We ask you, Lord,
to bless the earth, to give success to diligent labor, to prosper honest efforts, to supply our needs, to make our sharing a pleasure, to make service to you and others our joy.
O Lord, our Lord,
we look to you for all that is good. We depend upon you in all things. We rededicate our lives and service to you in whatever we do and wherever we are.
Hear us and help us, Lord.
Amen.
In our prayers this morning, a prayer of thanksgiving to God, along with Josh and Joanna Sinke, formerly Joanna Anther, who were blessed with a baby girl, Emmy Jo, born on April 30th. We ask God's blessings upon those who are experiencing physical needs, especially Terry Walter and Herman Roth, and we commend to God's hands Mildred Roth, who, as of when I last checked, is near death with her family at home. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of prayer. Forgive us for so often neglecting to communicate with you as you would wish. Move us regularly to bring before you our praises, our confessions, our thanksgiving, and our needs. We thank you, Lord, for blessing the lives of Josh and Joanna with the gift of a baby girl, Emmy Jo. Watch over this child and her new family. May they always rejoice in your presence among them. We pray that very soon through holy baptism, she may have the new birth into your family through Jesus Christ our Lord. Heavenly Father, we lift up in prayer the needs of others. We ask you to visit with your hand of healing and comfort those who are suffering physical afflictions, especially Terry and Herman. Watch over your servants. Give them strength and peace according to your gracious will for their lives. Eternal Father, you alone make the decisions about life and death. We ask you to show mercy to your servant, Millie, whose departure seems near. If it be your will, restore her and lengthen her earthly life. If not, O Father, keep her in her baptismal grace and prepare her to commit herself to your eternal care and keeping. Give her a truly repentant heart, firm faith, and a lively hope. Let not the pain or fear of death cause her to waver in confidence and trust. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Saying, Glory, 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 gl
will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Those dead marigolds, I didn't think were effective.
scheduled when we had the ice storm. So it was nice to see so many ladies coming out to share your fellowship, but also to share your mission. So everything that you contribute is part of that mission as well. Otherwise, I do not have anything specifically from the bulletin to draw attention to. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and as He talks to you through His Word, always take the time to talk to Him through prayer.